All right, my name is Matthew Goodwin. I'm here at Northeastern University. I'm an interdisciplinary assistant professor, and I'm jointly appointed in the Department of Health Science and the College of Computer and Information Science, and I direct the Computational Behavioral Science Laboratory. And the mission of my lab is to leverage advances in computational, behavioral, and cognitive sciences to better understand, support, and evaluate human development. I have a sister who is 2 years younger than myself, and I'm told that kind of right out of the gate I seem to have a real interest in interacting with her and spending a lot of time with her. I think that was an early sort of realization that I was interested in children and development. I studied psychology in high school. I did my first year of university at Oxford in England, and I was studying psychology and philosophy. The director of my program's wife ran a unit for children with autism. This is in 1994. So this is before Autism Speaks, this is before Rain Man, this is before Curious Incident in the Night. This is before there was a lot of public attention and recognition about autism. And so I really knew nothing about it at that point. I knew that I was interested in children and I was interested in human development, but I had no exposure to autism up until that point. If you look at the scientific literature in autism, and you go to the participant section where the sample is described, nearly all those studies, the participants that they see, have normal IQ, good verbal fluency. They're basically a convenient sample for the researcher because they can come to a lab setting. The segment of the population who's more severely impacted, who have intellectual disabilities, who have communication problems, have sensory problems, who have medical problems, these are the folks we understand the least. These are the folks that we need to support the most. And it was around that time that I started reading computer science literatures. There were two primarily. There's one called ubiquitous computing and another called wearable computing. So ubiquitous computing fields are interested in instrumenting spaces with cameras, with microphones, with radio frequency identification. The wearable computing field is interested in putting sensors, weaving them into clothes, into accessories that you can wear. This records information about the biology and the physiology of the people who are in that room, but it doesn't really give you much information about context. So I got interested in seeing, could you use ubiquitous computing approaches to instrument spaces, use wearable computing approaches to instrument people, and instead of bringing individuals into lab spaces, see if you can instrument people in spaces and take the lab to people. Computer science people see me as a psychologist, psychologists see me as a computer scientist. I'm really more of a generalist, and what I'm actually advocating for is not computing per se, is just empiricism, better ways to collect information so that we can confirm what we think we know, or show that what we think we know is not accurate, find an alternative explanation, and sort of keep on that process empirically until we have evidence for ourselves and to other people what we think is the actual truth. Now that we have cameras, that we have microphones, we're all on the internet, we're leaving little digital bits of information all over the place, right? Right now, those are all really harvested to advertise, market, and sell things, right? What if we used all those little digital bits that we're leaving all over the place to better profile individuals so that we can anticipate when they're going to have a health problem and reach them early and intervene and improve the quality of their life, right? Use this digital world we're living in for health purposes, not for making money off of selling people things because we've got a profile of your likes and dislikes.